about what we're going to leave with on tonight. Come on and bow your heads with us. Dear kind and heavenly Father, we thank you now. We give you praise, honor, and glory for all things. We thank you, Lord God, for this day because you made it. We thank you, God, that you've brought us down through whatever today presented us, and you've brought us to this place not looking like what we've been through. You brought us to this place encouraged. You've brought us to this place yet in our right minds. You brought us to this place yet healed and ready to run on. You brought us to this place satisfied that whatever our situation is, that you are right in the midst with us and that all things are well because of you. And so now, God, we invite you to come into the midst of us. Holy Ghost of God, teach on tonight. We ask in the name of Jesus that you would fill us to overflowing, that when we leave this place, our testimony will be, it was good for us to have been here. Now we give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory. It is in the name of your precious son, Jesus, that we lift our prayer. We say thank you and amen. Amen, amen. I am Pastor Marion King, the assistant pastor of Holy and Whole. Our senior pastor, Pastor Michelle C. Thomas, is our founder and senior pastor. And so we are just grateful for what God is doing in the midst of us. Even as we encounter different things along our journey, we pause to say thank you. We pause to give God praise. We pause to let him know that we recognize that he's still in charge. And only what he allows will confront us. And so we bless God on tonight for all things because he does all things well. If you have been journeying with us, you know that we've been in the book of Genesis. And on Sunday, Pastor Michelle spoke to us out of the book of, out of chapter 16 in the book of Genesis. And so our subject, her subject for Sunday was turning walls into wells. And you know the story. We've been looking at the last two chapters in particular over these last 2 weeks. And there seems to be a continuing theme in chapter 16, whereby Sarai decided to help God out. That's just the bottom line. She decided that Abram, and still at this point, his name had not been changed, but Abram had shared with her the promise that God had given them. And so they, at this point, had waited 10 additional years beyond the last time that God confirmed the promise. And so Sarai came up with a plan. She came up with a plan to move the promise along, to help God's promise out. And so we already know that we're starting out with issue, and issue led to issue, and issue led to issue. And so on tonight, we're coming to just go into the word, unpack the word, and see what in fact God is saying to us. Because if you living this life like I'm living it, if you are on this journey like I'm on this journey, I found myself in being sort of pictured in that scripture where I have upon occasion taken matters into my own hand, and I had the word of God, I had the promise of God, I even had confirmation, but it seemed like life was slipping past me, and it seemed like God was taking too long, and it seemed like he might have forgotten that he promised me, and so I decided I would help him out. And how many of you know that when we make that decision, we make a hot mess? Can I just be just transparent? Just a hot flaming mess. And then we got to go take all of our broken pieces, our ashes and our cinders back to God and see what he can do with them. Because the thing we know about our God is he is that God. He is that kind of forgiving God. He's that kind of all encompassing God, and that he does not reward us according to our iniquities, but he is faithful unto us. He's compassionate. He loves us, and he yet extends his mercy even after we make a hot mess. Anybody in the room with me tonight? Amen. Bless his name. There we go. We got, thank you for not putting me out there on that raft by myself. I promise you this has happened. Amen. Amen. But we have this testimony on tonight that we don't look like what we've been through, and we didn't get what we deserve. How about that? Amen. 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 And so I'm grateful every day. Am I able to get it 100% right every day? I strive for that, but being wrapped up in this casing right here sometimes prevents 100%, but I get as close as I can every day. And every day, God grants me brand new mercies. And every day, I get a fresh opportunity. And I'm thankful because I get another opportunity to do it better today than I did it on yesterday, to do it better tomorrow than I did it today. Learning from today's, wherever my feet didn't hit the ground quite right on today, I get a chance tomorrow to try to put that thing in the right perspective, to try to turn it back to God so that he will be pleased with my offering. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. And so there was a lot of meat. There was a lot of good stuff in the word, as it always is. But we want to extend the opportunity on tonight. We see, let me do a roll call here. I see Dr. Deans. I see Deacon Bruce. I see Mother Crooms. I see Minister-elect Payton. I see Deacon Colleen. I see Deacon Kamel. I see Sister Carlene. I see Deacon Janine. I see Brother Ray Deans. I see Minister Ruthie. Oh, I'm doing a roll call tonight. I see Minister-elect Diallo. They tell me I have a good call-out ministry. Don't even try me, because I will call you. Somebody say out. Amen. 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 And so come on, the water is troubled. Come on, jump in with both feet and get what you need on tonight. Give us what's in your belly and the pieces that stood out to you on Sunday that hit you right in that place where, oh, bless his name. Amen. And take us in on tonight. Of course, I set with the word, and the Lord has given me something, but I'm going to bring up the rear on tonight. You guys start us off. Amen. Deacon Kamel, I see you already walking, sir. Come on.
Hey, good evening. Calling a brother out. That's what I'm talking about. Put him in the hot seat.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hey, all glory to God. All glory to God. This message on Sunday was, it was so relevant, and it stuck with me because it was so real. And it's what we face and deal with each and every day of our lives as individuals in this world. And one thing that stuck with me that Pastor Michelle talked about was the brick wall. The brick wall. The brick wall is not about you. It's about what God is doing through you. The brick wall. What I come by tonight to tell you is that when you face trials and tribulations and conflicts and struggles in your life, or things that are not pleasing to you or pleasant to you, it causes you pain, it causes you stress, it causes you to lose sleep at night, it just causes you to be uncomfortable. Just know that God is doing a new thing in you. God does his best work when we're uncomfortable. God does his best work in us when we're uncomfortable. He gets our attention as well when we're uncomfortable. He gets it. He gets your attention when you're uncomfortable, because one thing about pain, nobody likes to go through pain for a long period of time. It is very, it'll wear on you after a while. It'll wear on you. And what we come to do is, because I come by tonight to tell you, you can trust God. You can have all the faith you want. You can have all the belief you want. But one trait that you don't have, we all gotta work on being waiting patiently on God to move. Waiting patiently on God to move. Pastor King spoke about it earlier this evening in her message was, we create our own plan when we don't sit back and wait on God to move. We sometimes want to tell God when he needs to move. I'm tired, God. This is enough. I've been through enough. Please, could you move forward, please? And when God don't move the way we want him to move, we create our own plan. We create a plan that we feel is best for us, that we know better, we know more than God. We pretty much lost faith in God. That's what we've done. We put him on the shelf. We said, God, you know what? I'll come back to you later, but right now, you know what? I want to do something that I feel is best for me at this moment. And as we looked at Sarai here, Sarai had already spoken. She had spoken to Abram and just said, hey, Abram, God has prevented me from having a child. God, it says in the scripture right here, it says basically in the first verse of 16, it says, now Sarai, Abram's wife, had not been able to bear children for him. So Sarai said to Abram, the Lord has prevented me from having children. She said it specifically. She said it because she hadn't had children yet, that God had prevented her from having children. And as you look down in the scripture here, look what happened after that. She made a decision on her own what was best for her and Abram to have a child. That's when it got messy, right there. When she stepped out of the covering of our Lord and Savior, and she made a decision in her flesh what she thought was best for her. And so I say tonight is that Pastor talked about vision. Talked about four types of vision. She talked about bad vision, good vision, God vision, and a new vision. The new vision is God's direction. God direction. I come by tonight to tell you that every day is a new challenge to trusting and waiting on God to move. Every day we wake up, it's a new challenge. Because we face different stuff each and every day of our life, different obstacles, different tasks. And so I come by to tell you today is that trusting and waiting patiently on God, being obedient while you wait on God. No, God never said that every day would be a bed of roses, every day would be easy. But he said he will never leave you nor forsake you. That's one thing he did say. And so I would say to you today, we got to be able to learn how to praise and worship God even when it don't work out in our time. We got to learn how to wait on God so he gets the glory and the praise from it. We're so worried about patting our own self on the back about what we did, how we made it happen, that we don't want to give God the opportunity. Because through this process, we grow. You grow through this process when you wait patiently on God. You experience the power of God when you wait on him. So I say to you tonight is that let's stop creating our own plan. Step back and just trust in God that he knows what's best in his time and not our time.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, sir, for getting us going on tonight. Deacon Bruce, do you have the scripture? I don't know why I'm asking, because I know you do. Will you pull the scripture up for us, sir? I want to reference two things that while Deacon Kamel was sharing that set forth in my spirit. Number one, you said when we make our own plan and we get tired of waiting on God, we say we petition God, or we say whatever it is we want to say to God, and you added please. And I wrote a note down there, Deacon Kamel, because sometimes we bombard God and we don't even say please. We just tell him we tired of waiting. It's been too long. I don't know if you heard me. You act like you didn't hear me. Or we get, you know, we go all the way there. Like we're in charge and God is subject to us. And then the second thing As you were sharing, this is what set in my spirit. You were talking about growing and being uncomfortable. And I see this example. Any of us who have had children, have been near children who are growing, especially our young boys, when they're growing in that sixth, seventh, and eighth grade year, sometimes the stretch that takes place in their body is painful. And I was thinking about that as you were talking, because growing pains are uncomfortable, but they are necessary. They're necessary to take us to the next level. They're necessary in order for our body to go through it's necessary for our body to go through certain changes so that we will be positioned and postured for the next phase. And so if we could relate what is necessary even in the natural to what's going to be necessary in the spirit, I believe that we would present ourselves with more of a reason to be patient. More of a reason to allow God to do what he needs to do, because after all, he has written the plan for us before the foundation of the world. So he's had, and he's already had our destiny determined. He knows where he has preordained us to be. And so we just need to give way to God's plan. Before we go any further, Minister-elect Peyton, you feel like reading tonight, baby girl?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Would you read the first six verses for us, please?
Yes, ma'am. Now, Sarai, Abram's wife, had not been able to bear children for him, but she had an Egyptian servant named Hagar. So Sarai said to Abram, "The Lord has prevented me from having children. Go and sleep with my servant. Perhaps I can have children through her." And Abram agreed with Sarai's proposal. So Sarah, Abram's wife, took Hagar, the Egyptian servant, and gave her to Abram as a wife. This happened 10 years after Abram had settled in the land of Canaan. So Abram had sexual relations with Hagar, and she became pregnant. But when Hagar knew she was pregnant, she began to treat her mistress, Sarah, with contempt. Then Sarah said to Abram, "This is all your fault. I put my servant into your arms, but now that she's pregnant, she treats me with contempt. The Lord will show who's wrong, you or me." And Abram replied, "Look, she is your servant, so deal with her as you see fit." Then Sarah treated Hagar so harshly that she finally ran away.
Amen. Amen. To God be the glory. Thank you, ma'am. One of the things that, and we're going to turn it right back over to you, but I want to put this in the atmosphere so that we can be thinking about it. One of the things that rested in my spirit was this. The Holy Spirit challenged me in this area. I was looking at what Pastor Michelle said about when she was talking about the brick wall, and she said, often we end up running into a brick wall, and it's triggered by our inability to wait. And so here's the challenge. Here's the challenge. This is where the Holy Spirit challenged me. Is it totally my inability to wait, or is it my reluctance to wait? Is it my resistance at the thought of having to wait? Is it my outright refusal to wait? Let me put that before you, because I offer this as the backdrop for this question. We often take Philippians 4:13 and we use it as our testimony, use it as a declaration in multiple things. The word of the Lord says, "I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me." And so if I can do all things, and that's my testimony, then I can wait. Because if God is in fact strengthening me and enabling me to do what is necessary to do to accomplish what I am, what is in front of me to accomplish, then I have the ability to wait. So therein lies, watch this, not an inability to wait, but a decision not to. And so when we have the ability to wait and we make a decision not to, that's not a fallacy in the program. That's not a fallacy in God's plan. That's outright intentional refusal not to wait. I just want to drop that in the atmosphere. I don't want to be the only one on the end of that whipping right there by myself. I just thought I'd put that out there. And you know, whoever can reap some benefit from that, come on in, Dr. Deans. I'm going to leave that alone for this moment.
It's not that we don't have the ability to wait. As you said, God will give us the strength that we need to wait. But we let our feelings in the earthly realm determine our actions in the spiritual realm. And that's wrong. We should give way to our feelings and elevate our minds, our actions, and our behaviors to the spiritual realm. And if we're in the spiritual realm, we have the ability to wait. I mean, did I pick up on what you said?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. You know, that thing challenged me when it said in my spirit, because I'm like, okay. Mm-hmm. So when I say, you know, we say, oh, I just can't wait. I just got to go ahead and do it now. I can't wait. It's just too much. I can't wait. Well, is it that you can't wait? Or you choose not to wait? And just the calm incision of that in my spirit brought about a moment. I mean, you know, I didn't really want to take ownership of it, but I have to. Because that is a decision I recognize that I'm guilty of at points in time. And I believe that each one of us bear a responsibility in that area when it is something, we all have something that we really have an urgency in us and we really want it to turn over and we really want it to happen and we want it to take place and get in order like by last week. And so I'm all the way on today and it hasn't taken place. And so my justification for my jumping up and moving and putting my hands in it is, I just can't wait no longer. Well, can you really can't wait, or are you choosing not to wait? I'm just putting that in the atmosphere because I believe we need to reevaluate where we are on the side of putting things in the air, on releasing our words, on framing what it is that gets us to a particular place of stall, gets us to a particular place of pause, gets us to a particular place of waiting and our attitude in it. Because it is the attitude that we approach it with that is going to make the difference. When I'm totally submitted, when I'm totally surrendered, you can't move me. But when I give myself an ounce of opportunity to be frustrated because a certain thing has not come forth yet, You know, what did grandma say? You give us an inch, we take a mile. Yeah. And so we look at this scripture and we look at how, as it's unfolding, we start wrong. Saray starts wrong. And then all the way through the scripture. And then watch this. She has the audacity when things blow up and don't go right in verse 5 to say, this is your fault. Telling her husband, Abram, the person she brought the plan to. He didn't bring the plan to her. The word says she brought the plan to him. Now he went along with it, but she still brought the plan to him. But when things blew up and didn't begin to work or didn't continue to work as she thought, as she had perceived that they would, then she goes back to lay blame on him. And further in verse 5, I just want to read this because this was intriguing to me. Then Sarai said to Abram, this is your fault. I put my servant into your hands. No, you put her in his bed. I'm sorry. But now that she's pregnant, she treats me with contempt. Well, what did you expect? Did you really expect the plan to go well? It wasn't God's plan. So what do we expect? That's why I'm asking it that way. When we insist on making an insert, a parenthetical insert in God's plan, do you really think it's going to work out the way the promise was intended to work out? Then she involves the Lord in this. I see you, Dr. Deans. I'm coming. Then she involves the Lord in this. The Lord will show who's wrong, you or me. How about both of you? Even though it was culturally accepted at that time to have more than one wife, because Abram had the promise, how about both of you are wrong? And how, let's just bring it back to our upbringing. When grandma says two wrongs don't make a right. That's plain enough.
Yes, that's to a particular.
Come on, Dr. Dean.
I was going to make the point that you were making, and even up in verse 2, when she was talking to Abram, she said, the Lord has prevented me from having children. She's throwing the Lord's name around like she's had a conversation with him. And she has not stopped, back down, and prayed and waited to have that conversation. She's just asserting what the Lord has done or has not done. And because of that, she was taking the Lord's name sort of in vain. And Abram was vulnerable enough to accept it. And in all of this, God had already talked to Abram. So Abram needed to take the hold of the conversation and say, God said, in the conversation. And then Pastor Michelle went on to say that, you know, after Hagar ran away, God spoke to Hagar, which was the first time that an angel had been sent to a person. So we humans get it all confused as to what God is directing us to do versus what we want to do. And that's what I think Sarah was, her problem was. She was doing her thing.
Amen. Yeah. How many times are we guilty?
Very often.
Amen. Amen. How many times do we say, well, this looks like what God meant? This looks like what I thought I heard God say. This sounds like what I thought, God said. This is similar to, he told me this, that the wagon was going to be red. This is orange. It's close enough. How about no substitution into God's promise, into God's plan? It's going to be good enough. Because God didn't promise us something and then fall short of it and say, oh, okay, well, I'll just push this over there. That's close enough. He doesn't operate. That's not our God. That is not how he operates. And so anytime we get to that's close enough, that's good enough, that's sort of kind of what he said, that sounds like we're already in the wrong avenue. We're already on the wrong street. We've already begun to accept within ourselves that it's okay to make this substitution into God's plan. Look at the upheaval that it brought about. Look at all that came out of this. Yes, the Lord sent the angel to speak to Hagar. Yes, he told her to return. But I looked further down in the scripture as I was reading, and we're going to do more of this as we feed into next week. And the angel also said, I'm in verse 11, you are now pregnant and will give birth to a son. You are to name him Ishmael, which means God hears. For the Lord has heard your cry of distress. Listen, this son of yours will be a wild man, as untamed as a wild donkey. He will raise his fist against everyone, and everyone will be against him. Yes, he will live in open hostility against all his relatives. Consider who the descendants of Ishmael are. Consider the descendants of Isaac, the promise. Consider how those people are still at war with one another, even in this present day time. So this is prophetic right here. The word already says that there will be unrest between Ishmael and his relatives, that he is basically just going to be angry. And he is going to be in a place of contention with everyone, and everyone's going to be in a place of contention with him. Consider the descendants of both of those sons and where we have been in the past years and even today. Consider. My God. So who else wants to sow into where we were on Sunday? That's just food for thought. Because I know as we began to talk about Isaac, as Isaac comes on the scene, that's going to be a better time for us to get a little more history into it. But I need you to begin to work on that and break that down in your spirit, because the scripture already tells us what's going to unfold. And we see it down through history, and we see it even unto today. So who else has a point on tonight that made or had a particular impact on them? Sister Carlene, are you coming in, sweetheart? I see you rocking.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening, everybody. Ma'am.
So this, I caught this message on the road, you know. I was,
amen.
I was traveling. It was so impactful. And so my issue was with Abraham. I'm not going to try to defend my sister Sarai, but I just have something to say on her behalf, if that's okay.
Come on in.
So, you know, I think her intentions were not bad to begin with. And that's what happens when our good intentions are driven by our own desires and not by God's word. Because I felt her intentions were, you know, Abram was getting up there in age. He was in his 80s. The promise had been given 10 years before. And she was just taking a look at things, surveying the situation, and decided that, okay. Now, this is how I saw it. She said, okay, so Abraham got the promise that he was going to have a son. It may not necessarily have to be by me. So this is what we do, right? We overthink things and we get in God's business. So same thing happened to Adam and Eve in the garden. Just overthinking things and getting God's business. Because what God said, he said. So I think she felt like the, you know, okay, we could work it out. It doesn't have to be by me. God didn't say it had to be by me. You know how we whittle it down. God didn't exactly say. So, you know, yeah, you know, take another wife and go ahead on and have a child. And, you know, like everybody said, trying to help God out. So I felt like she was coming from a position of overthinking things and that her intentions were not bad. But as it always happens with us, when we get our brain and our minds and our thinking into God's business, there are a lot of casualties, you know, a lot of casualties. So I felt a compassion for. So my issue was with Abraham. I started to say, like, I was saying, what was he thinking? How was Sarai able to convince him? She wasn't under the tree when he and God had their conversation. He was present. So he was the one that directly got the word. Why was she able to convince him? So I started thinking, well, maybe he was wondering to himself, well, maybe it should be my child. That's all I'm saying. I'm just putting that out there. And of course, Hagar, you know, there are a lot of casualties. And like Pastor King said, to this day, there are casualties because of the decision back then. So is it my inability to wait was the question, or my refusal to wait, or my lack of desire? I also want to add my lack of understanding. Because we can see a lot of things in hindsight. Hindsight is 20/20. We can see a lot of things. We don't set out to do devastation, not typically, but the lesson learned is God is never wrong. So when we follow the leading of the Lord, he is never wrong, even when it looks like we're at the end of the journey, you know, she's getting ready to turn 80 or whatever, you know. The human mind cannot really comprehend how God does things. And that's why we have to keep our brains from getting into what God is doing. Because I've seen God put some things together, take some things apart, work some things out, do some. I mean, in my lifetime, that has been amazing because it just blows your mind. So Sarai surveyed the situation and she drew the wrong conclusion. And I dare submit that Abram did too. He drew the wrong conclusion because his desire to have a child, God wasn't trying to say you can have a child by a different wife. He had only one wife when he got married. So he drew the wrong conclusion and had a domino effect. That's what I was feeling. Those are my few words for now. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. And you know, to your point, I don't believe that we are, I'm like-minded with you. I don't believe when we come up with these scenarios, when we come up with these helps, these creative helps that we insert in to help God out or to rush his plan along, I don't believe we are necessarily ill-willed when we do that. I don't believe that our plan is devastation when we do that. I am like-minded with you. But at the same time, as you were sharing, I heard you talk about hindsight. What would it look like? What would our journeys look like if we could start with hindsight? What if we could start with the looking at the possibility of devastation and what that devastation would look like and the effect that it could have? What if we slowed down enough and monitored our pace and put our desires under submission long enough to consider what could happen if we struck out and went running in the direction of our desire? Just food for thought, because we've got to have something that there has to be a turnaround. There has to be, yes, we are going to go through things on our journey. But I believe that there are some things that we create. But yet God is merciful. Even when we make a mess, he is merciful to restore us and to reposition us and to get us back on track, especially if there is an aspect of the promise that he has set in us and connected us to that is supposed to be beneficiary on the other end. It's supposed to feed another aspect of what God has set in motion. But what if we slowed our steps down, we slowed our intensity down, our desire down, our desperation down long enough to consider the devastation that could be connected with us making adjustments in God's plan? Is that enough to reroute us? Minister-elect Payton, I saw you on mic a moment ago. Come on in, sweet pea.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
There was two different spots that I was looking at that were kind of sticking with me. The first spot kind of ties into what everyone's been talking about at verse 5 and then at verse 6, where Sarai is talking about that this is all your fault. I made this decision, but now it's your fault. The Lord is going to tell us who's wrong, you or me. And I just found that interesting because it kind of, to me, it was in that mindset of, okay, so I didn't think all the way through what me doing what I thought God wanted me to do, not listening to what he said, but doing what I thought I heard him say, how that was going to pan out. And now what I'm going to do is, instead of taking responsibility and accepting that I made a bad decision, I'm gonna put it on everybody else who was involved alongside me, so that way I can feel less guilty. Is how I read that, because I've been guilty of, like, I made a decision, but I had outside influences being like, yeah, why not? I'll join you for the ride. But I was driving decision making, and at any point I could have said, you know what? This is not what God has directly told me. This is what I think he said, but I'm not fully sure. So why don't we slow up? But she didn't do that. No, and in this case, neither of them did that. But because she was driving it, at this point, it was like, are you going to stop your decision-making or are you just going to go forward? And she didn't. So in the end, yes, they were both wrong. But it was the way I read verse 5 was that she was putting the blame so she didn't have to accept her decision-making. Which I found was like, it's an interesting way for me at least to receive that, because it kind of reminds me that in the end, 50 people can sin alongside me, but if I led the sinning, it is my fault first. For my decision-making, for Peyton Arnett, it is Peyton's fault, not anybody else's. It's mine for making the decision to go forward. Now, yes, I can have driving factors that are pulling me, but that's temptation that I'm supposed to give it to God to fight that. But if I choose not to, that's my decision. That's my fault. So I have to accept my part in the wrong, which is how I was kind of reading that verse 5. So that was one thing that I was reading.
That's amazing. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead. Get your second one out.
The second thing. So when we go down to verse 9 and verse 10, where the angel is talking to Hagar. So it says in verse 9, the angel of the Lord said to her, return to your mistress and submit to her authority. Verse 10 goes to, then he added, I will give you more descendants than you can count. This was sitting with me in the sense that Hagar made a decision to run from the battle, from the, per se, the idea of hills and valleys, from the valley that she was in the moment. And to me, the angel telling her return and submit to the authority. This may not be the most correct way. And this is how I'm processing it, is that it was kind of like when you're in a moment and you're in a frustration or you're in a trench per se, all you want to do is climb out. All you want to do is get out of it. But there are certain trenches that you're supposed to sit in. There's certain trenches you just have to be in for the growth you need to get to the next step, to get to the next point. So the angel's telling her, I need you to return. I need you to go back and go and get through this section or get through this moment. And then I'll bless you even more. In the long run, kind of was to me that point of, even though it wasn't directly God, it was God telling me in a sense, there are some things that you're sitting in. There are some things that you're in right now that you don't want to be in, that it's so uncomfortable. And all you want to do is run away. All you want to do is get out of it. But there's a reason you're sitting in it. There's a reason you're fighting this fight. So for you to run away, I'm not going to be able to get you to the next level or to open that next door or to give you that next assignment in the list I have for your betterment, for your journey. So if you run away, you're kind of throwing yourself off the course. So yes, there are certain things God's not going to allow for us to go through, but there are also certain things that we have to be ready for the next step. So I feel like the angel telling her, go back, submit to the authority. It's not saying give up, lose all hope, but it's rather saying, this is a trench you're going to have to battle through. This is something you're going to have to get through for me to be able to bless you in the way that you're supposed to be blessed. But if you run away from it, I can't guide you the way that you're supposed to go. I can't help you get from point A to point B if you run past point A back to some other space. But those are the two things that were kind of sitting with me in where we were in the scripture.
Amen.
Pastor King.
Yes, sir. Come on in.
Can I piggyback on right there where the minister-elect Peyton just spoke about there? One thing that stuck with me from Pastor Michelle's message on Sunday, it says, when people don't hear from God, they were entertaining hearing Satan's voice. They will listen to Satan's voice versus God's voice. And what she talked about there was bad vision. Bad vision. When you have bad vision and you're not hearing from God, but you're willing to entertain Satan's voice. Sarai was pretty much, she thought this whole process was about her. And how many times is when we make up something about us versus God, and as Peyton was just spoken about it, and when it don't turn out right, they wouldn't want to blame everybody else for the whole situation and turn it out. Because people love to involve other people in mess. They love to get everybody else into their plan of what I created, what I thought was a great idea. And so when you get two or three others to agree with you, then the plan goes out. And then when it don't turn out in your favor, then you want to blame everybody else. Mm-hmm. Bad vision, taking things personal. Sarai took things personal because she couldn't have a child yet. It didn't happen in her time. She took it personal. She had an issue with what she took it personal and was angry about it. She was frustrated about it. It was something for her to prove and say, you know what, God, if you won't give it to me in my time, I'm going to create it my way, in my plan. She made it. She was intentional about how she went about it because she was all about her emotions, her feelings. This is what I want. This is the time I want it in. And so, God, you're not working. It's not working out in my favor the way I want it to work. And so she stepped out. She was selfish. She said, God, I'm not going to wait no longer. I got a plan. And so she created the plan. And so the ability to wait. She had ability to wait, but she made a decision not to wait. She had ability to wait, but she got tired of waiting. So she said, I'm going to create my own plan because God hasn't given me an opportunity to birth a child yet. And Pastor, my last thing I wanted to speak about is that you cannot fix what you're not willing to confront. You cannot fix what you're not willing to confront. That stuck with me big right there. Because people don't like to confront things. People don't like to have difficult conversations. A lot of this comes down to spiritual maturity. Spiritual maturity. Going to church don't make you mature in the word, in spirituality. Just coming to church in that building or coming on this virtual line, coming on Facebook. Spiritual maturity, your relationship with Christ, being obedient to his word, submitting yourself, willing to go through it all to glorify God, willing to go through all things, the good things that feels good to you, but go through it all, the good and the bad. And so tonight it's all about Sarai says she made a decision. Hey, I'm moving forward with this thing. I'm going to get a child. Whether it comes through me or I'm going to use somebody else to get a child for my husband, but I'm going to get one. And when it didn't turn out right, all chaos broke loose. And so I would say in ending is we have to truly realize and understand the decisions we make when we step out from God to create our own plan. Look at how it impacted other people, the descendants that came behind them for years to come. Think about how it impacts your children. Your children's children, when we make a plan that's not of God, that is not what God's plan is, but our plan. Think about that thing. It happens generations and generations over and over where people use this excuse today. This is what I experienced as a child. This is what I see my parents do. This is what I've always experienced. So I thought it was the right thing to do. People use that excuse, even though they know it's wrong, but they'll use that excuse to blame somebody else why they're doing what they're doing.
Isn't it amazing? Thank you, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Isn't it amazing that we can be intellectually astute? We can be students of the word. We can be a number of things that puts us above average in all of our thinking capacities. But when we experience frustration concerning what's not happening for us versus what's happening for other people around us, even when we have the word of God, even when we have confirmation from God that it's going to happen, because we don't see with our eyes. And this was a point, a sub point that Pastor Michelle mentioned on Sunday. She said chapter 16 deals with the eyes, it deals with vision, and it deals with hearing. And so when we don't see what we want to see, no matter how intelligent we are, no matter how reasonable we are in other things. We satisfy ourselves with coming up with alternatives that will, in our mind, work just as well. In our mind, we'll get a similar result. In our mind, will be the thing, the catalyst that will bridge the two parts, the part over here from me not having to the part over here to me having. So that piece that we insert to make those things happen, we're able to convince ourselves that we're good. This will work. I'm good right here. This will work. I see a comment in the chat. The idea of giving out the advice that you need to take, the ability to call everyone else out, yet refusing to admit that you aren't perfect yourself. That's good. That's got to be Minister-elect Payton.
Uh-huh. Yes, ma'am. It was when, as Deacon Kamau was talking, because I feel like where he is right where I'm sitting in that space, because that verse 5, as I was reading it for everyone else and just rereading it, going through the scripture, you know, in preparation for this evening, I feel like I've been in that, maybe not this exact situation, not this exact situation, obviously, but I've been in a position where I was so quick to be mad at everything else because of a decision I made. I refuse to accept that, like, I made a decision and it spiraled the rest of everything around me out to an extent that I couldn't control. And I didn't consider that that was a possibility because I was so, and in the point of vision, I wanted to make what I wanted to see visible. Because I couldn't see it and because I wasn't sure that it was there, I wanted to do everything in my power, in my mind at least, everything that I thought I had the power to do to make my vision present, bring it into fruition. Because I was like, well, this is here, which will help me make that vision come true. This is here, which fits into that vision, and this is here. So why not, if God happens to have all these things in line, he just hasn't pushed them in yet, why don't I just line them up for him? Why don't I just do it? Because, you know, it's right there. But it all that, the conversation of vision is like, I want to do it because I thought, oh, well, it's here, so let me do it. But it's not supposed to be done yet. You just have to wait. The point that everybody's been making that we keep coming back to is you just have to wait. There's no forcing and rushing the waiting period. You have no idea how long it is. You just have to sit through it. So that's why that point was sitting with me of like, blaming everyone else after you've made a decision doesn't help you because you didn't want to wait. Now you have to be able to admit and acknowledge your inability to wait and your inability to just let God be God and let God be in charge of, rather than, oh, I think I can do this because God put everything else in line. Why don't I just line it up for him? No, that's not how it works. If he puts everything there, there's a reason they're not lined up in front of you yet. So why are we rushing the waiting period? Which is why I feel like Deacon Kamau and I are on the same wavelength in this spot.
Amen. Amen. Listen, write this down. Job 37 and 14. Hearken unto this, O Job. Stand still and consider the wondrous works of God. Stand still and consider the wondrous works of God. I believe that is a place where if we would gravitate to, if we would just take a moment and gravitate back there when we get ourselves worked up in this manic state of having to have it happen right now. if we would consider just for a moment, just exhale for a moment and consider the wondrous works of God. Sometimes we just need a redirect. Sometimes we just need to slow our thinking down. Sometimes I find myself in a position where, or in a place where my mind is running like 5 miles ahead of my feet. And so I'm occupying two different places in time at the same time because my mind has me way over there. But my physical body is still right here dealing with the present, confronted with what is not, I'm not able to make it go any faster. I'm not able to make it go right. But my mind, I see that there's a glimmer of light over there. And so my mind has, I've given myself permission to operate in two spaces at the same time. I've given my mind permission to wander over there and to figure out what I can do to get me from here to there. Because I see it's reasonable. I see a little glimmer of hope. I see a little light over there. So what can I do? What I need to do is to stand still and consider the wondrous works of God. Consider what he's already done. Consider the fact that he has never left me. He's never abandoned me. He's always worked it out. And so there are multiple times that we can enact a redirect as opposed to leaping from where we are. Grabbing, I mean, half a thought, won't even let the thought complete itself. Just grab it and run. Never mind praying about it, because we don't even have a complete thought to pray on. Just grab, okay, all right, something's downloading now. And so we just jump up and run. Really? Because when we mess it up, and we will, we bring all of those broken pieces back to God for him to fix it as though he broke it. And so isn't that part of the blame game? Isn't that part of what we do over and over and over again in our humanity? I heard you, Minister-elect Payton, because too often we won't accept where we fell short. We won't accept that we had a big part to play in this derailing. And so when it derails, we sort of distance ourselves from it and we start pointing fingers. Well, if you hadn't done that, well, stop. You were wrong from the beginning. Let's get your peace. Let's work with that. Let's get your peace. Let's take ownership of that. Let's confront that. And then let's heal from that and move forward. Deacon Bruce, do you have frame notes with our points on them? The 3 points, bad vision, God vision, new vision. I know you do. Amen. While Deacon Bruce has moved, okay. We don't want to leave on tonight. I know that we're a little past 8:30, but we don't want to leave on tonight without reiterating and lifting those things. We don't ever want to depart talking about the crucifixion, talking about the pieces that don't work. because the whole reason we're here is to pour into each other, to pour into you, if you're with us on tonight, to understand that if you have made a bad decision, if you have operated out of poor vision, bad vision, incorrect vision, that it is possible to get back on track. If you have derailed, we don't want you to leave with this thought, well, I'm just over here, there's no hope. We don't want you to leave with that thought in mind. We want you to understand that it is possible, just like it's possible for us to go to the eye doctor and get corrective lenses. It is possible for our vision to be corrected. How does that happen, Pastor King? It happens by turning it over in entirety to God. Not just using him for up close vision, but using him for far away vision as well. Turn the whole thing over, release it unto God and allow him to handle it. I love the analogy that Pastor Michelle gave on Sunday. She said, God's timing speaks to what God has determined, not speaking to, it does not speak to something God has against us. Let me say that again. Bad vision, or God's timing, I'm sorry, speaks to what God has determined, not to something that God has against us. And so when things are not quote unquote working in our favor, when we can't turn the lens and bring it in closer or get a closer view of it, could it be that God's timing has not come full circle for that to come forward? Yes, he sent his word. Yes, he gave us a promise. Yes, he said that it will happen. Yes, he said that he's going to do it. And it seems like you can almost touch it. But no matter how much you strain, no matter how much you tiptoe, no matter how much you reach, you can't really get your hands on it. Could it be that the reason you can't quite reach it, the reason you can't quite touch it, is God's timing has not come full circle? Could it be that when we back off of that thing, when we satisfy ourselves with the fact that, okay, I did a little reaching, I tried a little something, that didn't work. I can see it. I heard God. It's over there. But perhaps I just need to back off and allow God to work his corrective vision, to work this thing out and bring it into focus in his timing. Could it be that we need to release it so that we can get in line with God's vision? I heard Pastor Michelle say on Sunday, a good vision looks good to us, but a God vision brings God glory. Yeah. And so on today, I submit to you that we don't need to stop with a good vision. We don't need to stop with being satisfied that, okay, I'm not looking at things side-eyed right now. I'm looking at things clearer. I got a good vision. I got a good grasp on it. But we don't need to stop with good. We need to continue until we get to God. Until we get to God's vision. Until we get to his release. Until we get to the place where he has ordained release and manifestation for us. Amen, somebody. And then we look at, listen, we look at the new vision that Hagar was given. We look at how it was that once she stopped running, who are we talking to today? who's running, who's shifting, who's dodging, who's hiding, because something has not worked out in your favor and you feel persecuted because you put your hands on it and it has not worked and it's blowing up in your face. And so now you're hiding out. Who am I talking to? We came to submit to you on tonight that if you would just stop, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Stop. Stop your running. Hear the voice of the Lord. And return to wherever he's sending you back to do those works that must be done there, to face whatever must be faced. Who am I talking to? You cannot get the promise. You cannot get God's best running from God's plan, running from chastisement, running from things that don't feel good, running from hiding out. Amen, somebody. And so,
amen. Tonight, amen.
As we prepare to go home from here, as we prepare to go home and we prepare to sit with chapter 16 and continue to allow the Lord to work in us, because this chapter 15 and chapter 16 have brought things very close to us and made them very personal and caused us to look at ourselves on a level and in a way that we probably have refused to look at, because taking that in-depth look is uncomfortable. Taking that kind of in-depth look doesn't always feel good, because we have to admit where we derailed and that it was not somebody else that caused us to derail. It was actually us. So it doesn't matter where we are pointing the finger. It doesn't matter where we want the blame to fall. It doesn't matter what we have offered as an excuse or reason to feel better. I submit to you on tonight, your feelings got you right here. Our feelings got us right here. So get your feelings off the table. Get your feelings out of the discussion. And turn this over to God. Turn it over to the only one that can make a difference. Turn it over. Hear his voice. Follow his instructions. Take a chance on doing his will. Let him work it out. We see the benefits of the promise, because when Abram and Sarai couldn't do anything else once they made this big old mess, but just wait on the promise. But how faithful was God to still bring it forth? He didn't discount them because they had made a big old mess. His promise was unconditional. And we see that when the promise came, Isaac came, that is the connection that continued the line to Christ. We see the benefit of the promise unfolding. And so if the promise has unfolded in that way in scripture, in that way in our lives, why can't we, come on somebody, wait on God? Amen. Deacon Bruce, you can let me have the screen. We want to leave in your hearing on tonight, as you read through the balance of the chapter, and Pastor Michelle brought this forward as she was bringing the message to a close on Sunday. How it is that Hagar, because of her encounter with the Lord, how she began to see him different, how she began to acknowledge the fact that you are the God that sees me. We want to submit to you on tonight that God sees you. He knows exactly where you are. He knows exactly what you're going through. He knows exactly what you're confronted with, and he hears your every cry. And so if God is God, and he is, why not elevate our level of trust in him? Why not take a chance on him? We testify of it. We tell others about it. But when we're confronted with actually making the application, the practical application to our lives, we fall a little short. So I submit to you on tonight, if you're under the sound of my voice, take your hands off of it. Let God do it. Now, I know many of you may not watch Dr. Phil, but Dr. Phil has a question that he normally asks his patients after they get their frustration out. He'll ask them, how's that working for you? Well, if you've been chasing your heels around in a circle and you've been doing the same thing over and over and over, looking for a different outcome, I just want to submit to you, how's that working out for you? So if that hasn't worked, my suggestion is you try Jesus. If that hasn't worked out for you yet, you keep doing, writing the same prescription, getting the same prescription fill, trying the same thing over, just coloring it different, but it's the same prescription, and you keep coming up in the negative, try Jesus. Try his plan. It's foolproof. It cannot fail. The thing we know about him is that he will not release us to anything until we're ready. So I'm gonna need you to have an attitude, a right attitude about waiting on him. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Stand still and consider the wondrous works of the Lord. Somebody say, stand still. Amen. Listen, we're getting ready to go home from here. If you don't know Christ in the pardoning of your sins, today is a good day to commit your life to Christ. Today is a good day to get a different outlook on life. Today is a good day to come to know him and see your life literally change before your eyes. So if you don't know Christ on tonight, go ahead and put your name in the chat on Zoom, or put your name in the feed on Facebook. One of our deacons, one of our ministers will get back to you. We count it an honor and a privilege to present Christ to you. It is the best decision that I've ever made. And I'm satisfied that we've had some saints on the Zoom that can unmute and say, me too, me too. I'm listening.
Me too, me too.
All right.
Me too.
It is the best decision that you can ever make. If you're on with us on tonight and you just want prayer, we understand. Thank you from our technicians. Thank you. We understand that life presents us with multiple things, multiple facets, multiple challenges, if you would. Sometimes we even feel a bit of struggle in there. But this is what we want you to understand. Listen to my voice. There is no growth that takes place without some type of discomfort. And so if we would change our perspective on the discomfort that we feel, that we're experiencing, we will begin to see the plan of God and the roadmap of God more clearly. I submit to you that sometimes our vision is blurry because we won't submit. And so if you want prayer on tonight, go ahead and put your name in the chat, put your name in the feed. We'll grab your name and put it on our prayer list. You hear us announce week after week that we have three prayer calls a day. One at 5 a.m., one at 12 noon, one at 8 p.m. And so we are honored to put your name on the prayer list and lift you before the Lord. Come on, let's prepare to go home from this place. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you now. We thank you, O God, for allowing us to sit at the table on this evening and to examine and to investigate your word, to sit as you unpack it and allow us to take different nuggets unto ourselves. We thank you, O God, for how it is you're able to make the word both general and specific at the same time. General application for the body of Christ, specific application for each of one of us individually. And so we bless your name. We thank you, O God, for the testimonies that will come down from here. We thank you, O God, for the lives that will be changed because you helped us to gain a different perspective. Help us to sit in a place where we've recommitted. Helped us, O God, to see us in this pattern of not being willing to wait on you. And so we submit ourselves to you on tonight, and we ask in the name of Jesus that you would help us now gain the pieces that we need, that we will wait on you, that we, oh God, will not put our agenda in front of your plan, that we, oh God, will not put our insertions in the middle of your plan, trying to rush to get to the promise. Help us, oh God, to wait on you. Help us, oh God, to be willing to take the steps that are necessary that you can grow us and stretch us and position us and posture us and ready us for possession of the promise. We give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory on tonight. We thank you for all things because you do all things well. It is in the name of your precious son, Jesus, that we lift our prayers. We say thank you and amen. Amen, amen. Listen, we can't wait to see you on Sunday, and maybe I need to say that a different way. We can hardly wait to get together again. So we look forward to seeing you on Sunday in our 11 a.m. worship, where Pastor Michelle will be breaking down the word again and filling us up, causing us to fill to the point of overflowing at the table. And so we look to share that worship experience with you. We look to grow with you every week in our Sunday morning worship, in our Wednesday night Bible study. We invite you to bring your children to church. We have our ministers, we have our deacons and our deacon elects that are waiting to impart into them. And so if you would just bring them to Sunday morning worship, let them log in on their devices so that at the time of the message, we're going to move them out into a breakout room with one of our ministers who are prepared to pour into them in a way that they can get the word. It's broken down. It's ready for consumption for them so that they can grow. And so we bless God for the opportunity. We invite you to share with this ministry, to support this ministry. This is a good place to plant. This is a good place to be a blessing. And so we honor God for all that you will do to join with us, to link arms with us across the airways, across the miles, that we can advance the kingdom together. Is that all right? Amen. Amen. Listen, there's only one way. Come on and unmute everybody. There is only one way, and you know what it is, to leave a whole gathering, and that is to go forward.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
God night. God night, everyone.
On Sunday. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen. Good night. Hey.